Excellent. So a very warm welcome to all of you for the session today. And, you know, just to kind of reiterate what the session is all about. So we are going to be talking about time management techniques on the GMAT. How do we really manage our time? And to a large extent, you know, what today's session I intended to be is, if you are preparing for the GMAT, or if you have started to prepare for the GMAT, you need to consider the factor that time is going to play, correct? So if I were to give you an ideal scenario and I say, well, there are no time limits, right? Believe me, most of you would be able to solve those 31 questions in quant and the 36 questions in verbal, right? What matters is that you do so in under 2 minutes. Right, that's where it ends up, making a huge difference. And just to kind of let you know that, you know, if you have not already liked the GMAT Club YouTube channel, make sure that you end up subscribing to this. We actually have a lot of plans with very relevant content that serious GMAT test takers usually feel, right? So these are usually phased when you started preparing for the GMAT. So we have a lot of content, a lot of webinars, so make sure that you hit the subscribe button, right? And here is another thing, that we also have a 7-day free so in fact, if you look at the link that we have provided, GMAT Club is also going to be offering a 7-day access to the GMAT Club tests, okay, for all the YouTube subscribers. So the instructions are there in the link that is given to you in the chat. So why don't you just go ahead and click that button and come back, and I'll be right here. I'll be sharing my screen with you, so that you, all right, so, excellent. So, yeah, so you're able to see the screen. So the time management secret that a GMAT 716 scorer knows. Just one clarification over here, and for everyone else, then so I have someone on the chat window saying that the sound quality is very poor. Okay, so is that a problem that everyone is facing with the sound audio quality? You can just let me know. Can't hear the voice. All right, let me do this. I'm not sure why that should be the problem. Okay, so Abhijit, could you just also confirm when you say that the voice, because I got my laptop in front of me, right? Okay, so fair enough, got it. So now you're able to hear me fine? Okay, good. So let me just kind of go ahead from this point. So like, this was a great example where if the sound quality goes down, please post it on the window so that I get to know that. But here is the deal, if one person can hear me, I assume all of you can hear me, please check your internet connection for potential disturbance, right? So coming to just a quick word, so I've been I'm the founder of Crack Verbal, and I've been a GMAT coach for over for almost 2 decades now, I've been teaching this test. So what I usually bring to the table is I like to think of GMAT more than a bunch of rules. I think there is a lot of psychology that kind of plays into the test. There is a lot of strategies that can provide you an edge on the day of the test, correct? One such thing is how well you can manage your time, which is what we are going to be looking at today, right? You can contact me over email, or if you're on LinkedIn, please feel free to connect with me. So today we're going to have a 1 hour session, out of which I'm going to spend the first 45 minutes trying to take you through the topic that I have. I will try to keep it shorter, but I would like to spend time answering your specific questions towards the end, right? So if you have any questions, I would request you to write it down and maybe post it on the chat window, and maybe Abhijit over here can act as my moderator, and if you can just pick the questions and ping me again, I'll be able to answer as many of those as possible. Some of our students, so why believe what I say? Well, many of our students have gone to score great on the GMAT. So whatever I'm telling you is not stuff that I've invented in any lab, but this is stuff that actually works for our students, right? And just wanted to kind of quickly go through some free resources that we have. So Abhijit can share this link. So one of the things that I've created is we have created a module called How to Study for the GMAT. This has, I think, close to 20 videos where I marry, what would be productivity hacks that work with study for the GMAT, right? Because a lot of it is how do we actually, keep ourselves motivated for 3 months? How do I take out 1 hour, 2 hours every day to study, correct? So those are the kind of things that this course really talks about. And given that you guys have already, been so motivated that you're joining me on a weekday evening, right? Whatever time it is at your time, it's still a weekday. The fact that you're joining tells me that you're motivated. I'm sure that you would like what you have. Please do let me know. You also have the Crack Verbal YouTube channel. So I'd mentioned about the GMAT Club YouTube channel. So make sure that you like both these channels, right? So even at the Crack Verbal channel, we have a lot of videos that we post, right? Especially on the GMAT and the MBA applications. And we have a ton of free resources. So I'll just ask Abhijit to post these links. So you can just go ahead and, download the ebooks and, read up on our blogs, right? So that's all I have for introduction. So let's now begin by, trying to understand what the task is in front of us, right? So if you try to understand the task, you'll realize that the GMAT itself, right, is composed of 4 sections, AWA, IR, quantitative reasoning, and verbal reasoning, correct? Now, I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking about AWA and IR, but let me just give you some strategies that a real high scorer would have for these sections, okay? So the first thing that you need to understand is you need to be conserving all your energy in the quant and the verbal section, because that's where your scores will really matter, right? So I'm not saying that you need to ignore AW and IR, correct? But if you look at most these schools, as long as you have a high enough verbal and quant score, even if you get an average AW and IR score, they are going to be pretty okay with it. Okay, Harvard is not going to reject you because you got a 5 on AWA, right? Harvard would reject you if you have less than, let's say, a 700 on the GMAT, correct? So focus on quant and verbal. AWA, the usual technique that most people follow is they have a template. So please go to the GMAT Club forum. Do you know anyone who wants to know trivia about GMAT Club? So, what is the most kudos that any post has received or any thread has received on GMAT Club? It's this one. It's called Chinese Burnt. So again, helped by posting the link here. So there is a template please go through the template. 30 minutes, 5 minutes, you basically plan out what you need to write. 20 minutes you write, and 5 minutes you just review. Keep it for review. Just keep it so that you know you have the whole 30 minutes for your AWA assessment. Okay, so make sure you plan your AWA that way. 5 minutes, 20 minutes, and then 5 minutes. All right, but don't worry too much about AWA. Correct. Make sure you avoid the usual errors, right? Typos, and you know sometimes the chain of thought is broken, right? So when we are copy pasting, especially, such things happen. So just make sure you don't do that. Integrated reasoning, 30 minutes, 12 questions. You know, to begin with, it's a tall task, right? In fact, certain things like multi-source reasoning may take a lot of time. So this is one strategy that some students have used, which is they will walk into the test knowing that they are going to miss out a particular question type, right? For example, I'm going to miss out on 3 questions that come in multi-source reasoning, right? So what happens in that case is the total number of questions that you have to attempt, that also gets reduced, correct? So instead of the 2.5 minutes, you end up, let's say, getting 3+ minutes, right? Or 3.5 minutes. So sometimes students guess one particular question type, but that's always a risk. You know, if you're going to take IR towards the end, you're already done with quant and verbal. My suggestion is to try your best and try to answer all the 12 questions, right? But even IR, I think timing is not the problem, okay? So we will be looking specifically at 2 things. We'll be specifically looking at, you know, quantitative reasoning, and we're going to be looking at verbal reasoning, right? So let me just get started first, quantitative reasoning, right? So quantitative reasoning, the thumb rule over here is very simple. You have 2 minutes per question, correct? In our experience, right, I don't think that data sufficiency or problem solving by itself is going to take. For example, you can't say, unlike in verbal, that I know that data sufficiency is going to take a lot lesser than, let's say, problem solving, because it depends on the type of question, right? Sometimes there are tough data sufficiency questions which could take more time than a easy problem solving question, for example, right? So there is really no differentiation between the 2 types. So the thumb rule here is, remember that the GMAT has a countdown timer, okay? It's not a count up timer, it's a countdown timer, which means at any given point, it will tell you the number of minutes that you're left with, correct? So you need to know that the total time that is left should actually not, you know, keep the multiple as close to 2 as possible, correct? As close to 2 as possible. So that's really the strategy in quant. I'll be taking a few misconceptions that people have about allocating time. But my suggestion would be that as much as possible, okay, try to make sure that you are keeping this 1:2 ratio or the 2x ratio where you are, you know, kind of ensuring that's the number of questions left. Okay. Now, when it comes to verbal, the same strategy becomes a little tricky, right? Because what happens now is you have 65 minutes and you have 36 questions, correct? So if you actually do the math, it works out to about 1 minute, okay, per question. Now, if you are looking at, or rather, it's 1 minute, and so if you look at it, if you just do a math, right, you will realize that a lot of times, reading comprehension, critical reasoning, correct, could take more time than, for example, sentence correction, right? So it's not that we have to consider only the fact that it's a verbal question, but we also need to consider the fact that what kind of question it is, correct? So we have 108 seconds. And we have, you know, a verbal question. So a lot of times, and I'm going to be talking about this a little later. One question that I've had students ask me is, how do I really know that I have to spend 108 seconds per question, correct? Is it possible, right? Now, I want you to think about this question, okay? I want you to think about it. which is, how do you really know 108 seconds are over? Or should you keep that 108 seconds as a measure that you should aim? What if I were to give you 10 questions, or let's say I give 10 questions to someone, right? And he ends up taking, let's say, 106 seconds, 108 seconds, 110 seconds, 112 seconds, 110 seconds, 108 seconds, like that. For the 10 questions, he takes roughly approximately 108.25 seconds, let's say. Do you think he has done a good job? Right? Do you think he has done a good job? Do you think that a person who scores very high on the GMAT, and you can let me know in the chat window, a person who scores very high on the GMAT, is this what he is doing? Is he managing time per question level, saying that I'm going to spend so much time per question? Go ahead and let me know in the chat window. Right? And I'd also like you to let me know that if you like this webinar, if you like the content, I would love for you to go ahead and let me know by hitting the like button. Right? So that means I know that I'm resonating, the content that I have, I shared with you is resonating. Correct? Is there still a problem with the... There is still a problem with the audio, but in case nobody else is, I'll just go ahead. Now, the thing is, there is no way you can actually measure yourself. This is not an archery competition, correct? This is not a place where the idea is to hit the average. Thank you, Ishan. So the idea is to say that, look, if 108 seconds is the average, and remember, average is a very misleading metric, right? Why is that a misleading metric? Because let me ask you this, right? What do you think is the average age of people who wear diapers, right? Guess what? It's somewhere in the mid-40s. Now, the point is, it's not that a 40-year-old wears a diaper, but if you actually take the average, so either a newborn baby is going to wear a diaper, or someone in his 80s probably wears a diaper, an adult diaper, and that's why the average comes out to, you know, correct? Similarly, the point is, you know, when you look at this number, 108 seconds, please don't get carried away saying that that is any kind of objective that I need to meet. That for every question, I need to hit that. See, the only way such an absurd thing would happen is if, let's say, you have solved a question in 60 seconds. But what are you doing? You say, you know what, let me take more time. Since I have 108 seconds, let me spend the next 48 seconds trying to see what are the other reasons that this question becomes right. You wouldn't do that, right? Similarly, let us say that you have crossed the 108 seconds limit. Let's say you are around the 2-minute mark, correct? But at that point, you realize that you are so close to getting to the answer, you need to invest 30 seconds more, right? It would be foolish for you to actually throw away that question. I would encourage you to go ahead and, you know, take that extra 30 seconds, which is about 2.5 minutes, okay? And that's what I would suggest. You know, you would do if you look at questions. I'm just looking at it in terms of my voice clarity, because the room that I'm in does not have a lot of echo. So let me just go ahead and continue with what I'm saying. All right, so what do I do? The first thing is understand the importance of having a pacing chart, okay? So what is a pacing chart? Now, in the case of quant, we looked at this whole thing where you have 31 questions and you have 62 minutes. So it's a very, okay, let me do this. Let me just try to get a headphones and see if it fixes things. Okay, just give me a second. Just check if I could potentially improve this, because so let me know if this improves the voice clarity in case you are able to hear me, but I'm just going to go ahead. So I'm actually looking in front of my laptop, so it's not too much of movement. So what's a pacing chart, right? Now,
What I would want you to do is, I don't want you to think of GMAT as one contiguous test, okay? If you're going to try to manage 65 minutes, it is virtually impossible, okay? So instead of managing 65 minutes, what I would like you to do is think of GMAT. Now, verbal has 36 questions, correct? So what I would like you to think of is think of it as four mini tests, okay? Four mini tests of about 9 questions each. Now, instead of me looking at the GMAT as 36 questions, what I've done is I've broken it down into a smaller chunk, okay? And the smaller chunk is about 9, questions, right? Now, what I do is I give 15 minutes, okay, to each of these 9 questions. Now, if I give 15 minutes to these 9 questions, you will realize that I would have given a total 60 minutes for my 36 questions. But what I want you to do is you have an extra 5 minutes. Think of that extra 5 minutes as buffer time. Now, what I mean by buffer time is if you end up slipping in any of these, segments of 15 minutes, right? Assume that you have an extra buffer of 5 minutes that you can use up, correct? So in that case, even when you're preparing, right, even when you're practicing, all that you need to do is think of it as running a marathon, correct? Now, when you run a marathon, okay, so actually, I'm not able to write, so I'm just trying to see if there is a better way for me to use the notes over here. So, is there a way to... No. So, I'm just going to be speaking it out, so you can maybe... I'm just going to write it over here, so maybe... Can I write it in the comments? You can just look at it. 9 questions, okay? And you have 15 minutes, correct? So you do 9 questions in 15 minutes. That's the pacing that you need to have for yourself, correct? Like as I was saying, if you are a marathon player, a runner, correct? You want to time every segment, right? So you want to say that, look, this is the speed at which I need to run. If I'm able to run at the speed of 9 questions in 15 minutes, I'm doing good pace, correct? And what you do is, before you start the test, what you can do in a sheet, you can actually write down, okay? As I said, the GMAT is a test where it goes, the clock runs in reverse, which means it is going to be 65 minus something, right? So what you can do is, let's assume that the first 5 minutes, okay, or the extra 5 minutes, Abhijit, can you just help me? Are you able to see this, the importance of having a pacing chart? You're not able to see this, number one, importance of having a pacing chart, because I have not written anything on the screen using any, tool. I'm just speaking through it, okay? Anybody else has a problem? I'm seeing number one. Abhijit, if you can just help me. I have not written anything on the screen, so I just wanted to check with you guys. Okay. I'm just showing that this is the next one. Are you able to see the screen change? Yeah, slide. That's it, Nitin. So I have the slide with me. So as long as you're able to see the slide, I'm not writing. I couldn't write notes because I got an issue. I just realized that I don't have that option on. If anyone can help me of how to write it on Google Slides, because I just realized slides instead of the usual one that I have, I usually put it on a PPT and write, but I seem to have Google Slides now. Okay, so I'm sorry, I'm just kind of digressing from the presentation. Can we just get back, right? So all of you got what I'm saying, right? So what you need to do is, when you are sitting at that point, okay. Exactly, Saketa. Thank you so much. Okay, because I don't have my bamboo pad with me. So what you need to do is take that 65 minutes, okay? So when 65 minutes are there, okay, you have all of 36 questions to do, correct? So, sorry, 65 minutes and you have all the 36 questions to do, correct? But what you do is, you do, when you go to, let's say, 40 minutes, right? What you try to do is, give this extra 5 minutes in the starting itself, okay? So let's assume that the first 9 questions, instead of taking 15 minutes, you're going to take 20 minutes, correct? So then what will happen is, you'll have approximately 45 minutes left, and you'll be done with 9 questions, which means you'll have 27 questions, correct? And then after, let's say, another 15 minutes, right, you will be left with 30 minutes and you will have about 18 questions to do, right? And then if you are able to get into the last 15 minutes with 9 questions to do, you have robbed it as far as timing is concerned, correct? I'm sorry, I couldn't write it on the screen. That is where I had actually kept the screen, but my bamboo pad is not working, so I'm just using the chat comment to type it. So what I want you to do is, if you can just write down this as a table, okay? So 65-36, you don't need to write. To be honest, 65-36 is what you already know. Just write these three values, 45-27, 30-18, 15-19. Which means, with 45 minutes to go, I should have, you know, it would be 45 minutes to go, 9, right? Because we are counting that way. So then you have 30, you have 18, okay? And with 15 minutes to go, you should be on question number 27. So with 15 minutes to go, if you are on question number 27, as I said, you have rocked it, don't worry. Make sure you have the spacing chart with you when you're doing verbal. For quant, you don't need it, correct? Quant is, I think, fairly easy. Second is the fallacy of the first 10 questions. If you go to GMAT Club and if you look at people, people have tried to analyze this mystery for a long time. They try to see, you know, if I were to get the first 10 questions right, I have heard that I will do very well on the GMAT. See, what happens is, why is this important to timing, and what does a 760 scorer know about this? So the first thing, that people who score very high on the GMAT have a very good pacing, correct? That's the first part. The second part is, you know, people have this belief that, you know, in case the first 10 questions I get it right, okay, I will be able to get, you know, a very high score on the GMAT. And then if I make mistakes, it's still not going to matter, okay? So first of all, I want to bust this myth, okay? I'll tell you why, okay? So the problem is that GMAT will always start with what is called as an average difficulty level question, correct? Now what happens is, the whole problem is when you start having, correct, a string of questions, and that's the whole point, Akshat, that in the event that you start getting the first questions right, what is going to happen is that the difficulty of that question is going to increase, correct? So what you need to do is, you need to conserve your energy, because see, it is not that you get the first 10 questions right and then you start making mistakes, GMAT is going to be forgiving, right? So you need to maintain at least for a lot more, correct? So what happens, the first few questions could be very easy questions, right? Because you are already at a 700 level, correct? When I say easy, I am saying that a 600 level question would be easy for a person scoring 700, correct? So if the level, the first few questions should be easy for you, right? So over there, just because you have this pressure that I have to get the first 10 questions right, what happens? People, they foolishly end up spending a lot more time in the first set of questions, correct? So the whole idea is, you end up getting the tougher questions somewhere after, let's say, question number 8 or question number 10, but you have invested way too much in the starting of the test, correct? Remember that if you want to do well on the GMAT, overall, you have to do very well, okay? What it means is that the moment you start making mistakes, GMAT is going to get you down to a lower level, then you cannot fight back, you know, it's just adaptive at that point, correct? I understand that the variableness of the adaptability is slightly higher to begin with, but at the same time, remember the tougher questions would be coming later. Here is one more thing to question you on, correct? This correlation between time spent and accuracy, correct? I have heard a lot of students say that, I started today's webinar by saying that, given infinite time, maybe all of you get that answer, right? But here is the deal. On the GMAT, correct, if you're going to give yourself, let's say, a minute more, you really think your accuracy is going to go up. Here is what I want you to do as an experiment, okay? Take up 10 questions in any topic, could be quant, could be verbal, okay? And I want you to mark your answers, okay, whatever you can do within the time, right? Within the, let's say 20 minutes that you give yourself for 10 questions, mark it. Wherever you have a doubt, wherever you think you need more time, go ahead and put a star, right? Now, what will happen is after you kind of, take that 10 minutes, go back and this time, don't give yourself any time limit, okay? Which means what will happen is that without any time constraint, I would like to know whether you would have actually changed your answer options. Many a times, what you will realize is that when you go back to the question after you've given it, let's say, 2.5 minutes, you solved it, whether you got it right or wrong, you have moved on. When you go back, you spend more time, but that time is probably spent in justifying why your answer is right, correct? For example, in critical reasoning, if you have picked the right answer choice, or if you have picked an answer choice for strengthen, correct? The more you look at it, the more you will be able to justify, correct? Same thing for RC. So the thing is, if I were to give you 2 minutes, and let's say I give you a bunch of questions, and let's say your accuracy is 80%, okay? If I give you 3 minutes, your accuracy is going to go from 80 to 85. Okay, but here is the problem. If you give each question 3 minutes, then remember, you're also robbing a question of the time that it deserves, correct? Which means that if I were to give you 1 minute per question, you realize your accuracy is not going to go from 80 to 95. Your accuracy is going to plummet from 80 to, I don't know, maybe 40-45%, because you just can't solve a question in a minute, right? So, I think at some point, you need to understand that just spending more time is not going to help you, and you need to know that you need to know when to cut your losses. Which brings me to the fourth point, correct? Now, other thing that a 760 scorer does very well is he knows that he is invested in that question only so much to get it right or wrong, right? I mean, that's the whole point. He is there to solve it. The problem is many a times when people, look at GMAT questions, they tend to get personally invested, right? So here is what happens, okay? I'll give you a classic play. Let us say we are talking about critical reasoning, okay? Now, critical reasoning, a person may end up reading the stimulus, not really understand what the stimulus is saying, correct? Get to the question, then while he's reading the answer choice, he goes back to the stimulus, reads it more, he gets confused. Now, what happens is at that point, correct, he takes a deep breath and he says, you know what? I have already invested 1.5 minutes understanding this question. Okay. Why don't I now spend, another minute, okay, going and solving the same question? Terrible strategy. Of you is doing this terrible strategy. See, if you did not understand it the first time, correct? There is a very good chance at that moment, at that point, you are not going to understand it by just rereading. This is another thing that I've seen in reading comprehension, correct? They will just go into something and they just keep reading and reading and reading, right? Just because they are already invested into something. So you need to understand that just because you spent a minute or a minute and a half on that particular question, it doesn't mean that you're going to put more bad money after bad money. You know what I'm saying? Like, don't invest more time just because you spent one and a half minutes and you didn't understand that. Okay. In fact, the whole idea is to kind of also know when to guess on the GMAT. Okay. According to me, that's a very key thing that people who score very high actually do very, very well. Correct? Be it sentence correction, be it critical reasoning, they have a sense of when to guess. What I'm going to do is I'm going to give you some very simple tips to help you understand when to guess. Correct? So let's start with reading comprehension. Now, reading comprehension on the GMAT, you're going to be given four passages and you're going to be answering about 3 to 4 questions per passage. Okay? The whole idea is to kind of look at it and ask yourself, you know, what is the time that you can give yourself per passage? Now, at Crackverbal, in our course, we teach a technique by which you have to solve a passage, like read a passage in about 2 minutes and spend 2 to 6 minutes in answering the question, which means totally about 7 to 8 minutes per passage. Now, you usually get about 3 to 4 minutes for a passage, 3 to 4 questions per passage. So what happens is, instead of me guessing an entire passage, I've had people who have actually told me this, okay? But instead of me guessing the entire passage, what I would do is, I would actually pick and choose the kind of questions that I want to guess. So it is a perfectly okay guessing strategy for you to walk into a passage, okay, and say that out of the 4 questions, I'm going to go and guess on one of them. Now, think about it. What are the kind of questions that you will probably guess on? Would you like to guess on a main idea or a primary purpose question? Perhaps not, right? Because you have spent time reading the passage, you'll answer it. Should you be guessing a passage where it says the word highlighted in yellow? Okay, what does that mean? Should you be guessing those questions? Perhaps not, because you know, you just need to go back, it's referenced in the passage, read one line before, one line after, and you get a context, try to answer the question. But what if you get a question which says, which of the following statements, predictive statements, would the author most likely agree with? Okay? Now, you know that that question is going to take a lot of time. Correct? I mean, that's just the nature of it. Okay? Because it's an inference question, you have 5 answer options, and there is a good chance that for each of these answer options, you might have to come back to the passage to read relevant portions. Is that a good question to guess? Hell yes. The kind of question that you want to guess. This is for reading comprehension. What about sentence correction? Sentence correction, the only time that I would guess is when I'm between the last 2 answer options, correct? And at that point, sometimes it is best, you know, we try to think too much, but sometimes it's okay to go ahead, commit an answer and move on, okay? The only time that I would guess an entire question in sentence correction is then if it's a multiple modifier, entire, you know, sentence, underlined kind of, you know, sentence, that is when I would actually end up guessing on a sentence correction question, but otherwise not much there. Critical reasoning, when to guess. Critical reasoning is one topic that is going to take the maximum time, at least as far as verbal is concerned. GMAT verbal is going to take you easily over 2 minutes. Okay, that is the nature of CR questions. Questions that are very tough. Okay, so here is what I want you to do. Do not get to the answer options if you do not understand the stimulus. Okay, so when you read a stimulus, lot of times what happens in GMAT is people read this critical reasoning problem like in one flow, like they are doing reading comprehension. No, this is not reading comprehension. In reading comprehension, we are going to come back to the passage, okay? But in critical reasoning, we will not come back to the passage. We will come back maybe once, but the idea is for you to understand it well before you get to the answer title. If you have not understood the stimulus, my take would be, please go ahead and, guess it at that point, okay? Now, that's what I wanted to discuss. I'm just trying to look at the questions over here. So I see there are a few questions that we have. So let me just go ahead and take the questions now. So the first question I have, so just give me a minute. I'll probably just read through what you have written. So in case you have questions, you can post it now. I'm going to take up this question by Shamik Vidyarthi. Okay. Cover up for the... Okay. So, I will try to answer what Richard is trying to say. So, Richard, since I'm having the webinar, I'll have the privilege of, taking up Shamik's question. See, when people come to me and they ask me this question, right, which is first 10 questions, if I get it right, okay, what are my... See, first of all, I tell people that knowing this strategy is a lot to do with self-awareness, correct? For example, if you are such a genius that you can get the first 10 questions right, then my advice to you would be to please get the next 26 questions also right. No. Score 800, who's stopping you? Correct? So I think the first thing is to enter the GMAT with a mindset that we are not here to maximize everything. Correct? So when you look at a question, what you're trying to do is you need to, make sure that every question, you are increasing your probability of getting it right. Okay. Now think about it. You start every question not with 0% probability. You start with a healthy 20% probability of getting it right. The thing is, the journey is to go 0% probability when any of the answers could be right, down to 25% probability when you eliminate one answer option, 33% probability when you eliminate two answer options, 50% probability when you eliminate three answer options, and finally, your goal is to take it to 100%. But what happens, sometimes it may be more beneficial for me to say that the time that I need to invest in this question, okay, is not worth the returns I'm going to get. See, the wrong question to ask our brain is, will I get this answer? If you ask your brain with a billion neurons, well, it's going to say, yeah, sure, I'll be able to get it. But the right question to ask is, can I get this question right in under 2 minutes? Correct? And that's where it matters, that you guess correctly. See, even the pacing chart that I gave you, right, the whole point is to pace yourself. To answer Shamik's question, you can pace yourself to a 600 also. That means your level is a 600 level, but you have done the best to reach that. Similarly, if you pace yourself well and you score a 700, okay, that means your level is 700. The pacing has helped you reach to the maximum of your potential. The pacing by itself cannot make you score 800. I hope you understand that logic, right? So when anybody who has taken the GMAT will also realize that human psychology plays a huge role, correct? So when you're staring at that screen, right, the white and blue screen, time passes away like whoosh, correct? So many a times what I've seen is students, they don't optimize the algorithm in such a way that they benefit. So they need to pace their mistakes, correct? As I said, in your practice, if you are able to, spend, as I said, 9 questions, if you are able to do it in 15 minutes, use that as your pacing, correct? And if you are able to do that consistently, what you will realize is you will have an 80-20 rule, okay? 80% of the questions will not bother you. You will be able to do it in time. 20% of the questions will bother you. These are the rogue cases. Questions that may take sometimes 4 minutes, 5 minutes. I have had students come and tell me, Arun, I just spent like 6 minutes on one question. These are the questions you need to avoid. These are the questions where you need to know when to guess intelligently, especially when you are under that pressure on the day of the GMAT, when your eye is not really looking at the clock. Okay. So first of all, that reading comprehension is not about vocabulary. It is about tonality. Okay. So I will tell you the difference between vocabulary and tonality. Okay. Vocabulary is when you use a word, okay, which has a very difficult meaning, correct? So if I were to give you a very tough Shashi Tharoor type word, that could be vocabulary. If you ask me, GMAT is not going to test you on vocabulary. They have made this test culturally neutral, okay? So they want to make sure that vocabulary is not a problem. However, the problem could be tonality, okay? Why is tonality important? So tonality is important because let us say that there is an RC passage where they are talking about a particular author, and then they say that, oh, the author in the end, correct, admitted that he could have done something. Okay. Now, when you use the word admitted as opposed to the word said, okay, I could have said, no, the author said something. But if you say the author admitted something, when do you admit? You admit if you are wrong. Now, if you know the multiple meanings of the word admit, correct, you will realize that, you know, one of the meaning of admit is to accept a mistake, right? So this is what happens in RC. It is not about vocabulary alone, correct? I just wanted to make sure you understand this. Someone has asked, how important is it to attempt all questions? Aditya, you need to be attempting all 36 questions in order to maximize your score on the GMAT. Okay. And when I say you need to attempt all questions, attempt as in take a look, make a decision, right? After reading the question, if you want to make a guess, that's fine. But even that is attempting. I would suggest against, these blind guesses. So many a times what happens, students, they don't see the time. In the end, they end up with 5 minutes and they have like 7 questions or 8 questions to go. What do they do? 3-4 questions. They just go blindly mark it. Okay. That is going to be hugely detrimental to your score. Please don't do that. Okay. That's what a 760 scorer would do, right? He's smart enough to know how to manage it. How to improve time efficiency? Pragun, as I mentioned, what you can do once you are done solving a CCR RC initially, correct? My general thumb rule is 7 to 8 minutes for 7 to 8 minutes for a passage. Okay, you can all make a note of it if you want. 7 to 8 minutes per passage. That's all you need to give. About 90 seconds for section question, and about 2 minutes for critical reasoning question. Okay. Keep that as your aim. Initially, do not worry about timing, worry about accuracy. See, timing is an optimization challenge, correct? That will come only when you are very thorough doing the basics of what is expected of you, correct? So that's what I would say. And as I said, the 9 questions, 15 minute thing, please keep that. Maurya, by the way, guys, in case you liked this webinar, please give it a like. In case something you disliked about it, that's also okay. You know, you can dislike this, but please let me know your feedback so that next time when I prepare content, I'll be able to improve on that. Okay. So just go ahead and like those like and dislike buttons. And in case you have not subscribed, please do so also. I'm going to take the next question. Should we buy GMAT mocks? According to me, there are two free tests that are available to you apart from the GMAT club test, which is available on MBA.com as a starter package. My suggestion, GMAT, MBA.com tests are gold standard. Okay. They are able to replicate the algorithm, the quality of the questions. You are not going to get there anywhere else. It's superb. My suggestion, try to use all the MBA.com GMAT mocks. Okay. Mr. Panchal, how far can guessing get us in the exam as far as score is concerned? See, what guessing can do, intelligent guessing, okay? Intelligent guessing can make a difference of 20 to 30 points, which means if your peak day, as far as your ability and competence is concerned, you can score a 630. Being very smart and being very strategic about the exam can get you to a, you know, from a 630 to a 660. 20 to 30 points is what I would venture as saying, correct? So, for example, it's the difference between getting a quant 48 or a quant 49. It is the difference between getting a verbal 36 or a 38. So, it is not huge, but it is significant, especially when we are trying to optimize every little thing as far as GMAT is concerned. Okay? Avinash, my suggestion is to buy the MBA.com mocks. That's what I would say. And also, please use the GMAT Club ones. I'm going to take the next question from Shamik, again, about the algorithm. Does the algorithm take the time taken per question? The answer is no. Okay? They won't know whether you have guessed. This is a question that we have, I could say, got it verified from official sources. So, we have asked the test makers, GMAC, and we know for a fact that, you know, they don't take this into consideration. Okay? Leaving a question versus doing a question wrong. Maurya. So, let's say that you are on question number 33 on verbal or question number 29 in quant. Okay? And time is running out. You have only 1 minute left. You have three questions. Okay? You are in the middle of question number 33, for example. Should you invest the whole time solving question number 33, or should you quickly go ahead and mark some random letter for question number 33, 34, 35, 36? What should you do? My suggestion, do the latter, which is make sure that in that last 1 minute, go ahead and mark all those four questions. Get all of them wrong, doesn't matter. Okay? But, you know, it is better for you to do that than for you to leave those questions. Okay? So that's what I would suggest. One more question I'm going to take, and then I will be this. Anubhav actually had a question on tips on smart guessing. I actually covered that, you know, to some extent. But here is one smart guessing tip that I would like to offer. When should you get a question wrong? When should you guess? At the end of 30 seconds? Or at the end of 2 minutes, okay? At the end of 30 seconds or end of 2 minutes? Here is my answer. It is better that you actually guess at the end of 30 seconds, okay? Better that you guess faster than for you to wait. So my suggestion is always be sensitive, always be conscious. For example, your first question. You know, if you are a normal, rational human being, no matter how long it will take, the first question on the GMAT, you will always give it that time, correct? Problem is, at what point you say, you know what, I think I have given enough time to this question. I need to make an educated guess and move on, right? That is where I think it becomes very difficult. By the way, you could also share the link for the free course, How to Study for the GMAT. I would like your feedback on that. So, just going back to that, so that's what I would suggest. Okay, which is mark a random guess faster than wait for longer. Okay, because guessing in 30 seconds, you're buying time. You're buying extra time. When you guess at the end of 2 minutes, you're not guessing. It's called giving up. Because you didn't know what to do, you had to pick something. You are not in control. When you guess at the end of 30 seconds, you're in control. When you actually mark an answer at the end of 2 minutes, you're giving up. You're not in control. GMAT has already taken control from you because it wasted your time, right? So that's what I would like you to remember. Okay. I'm going to take this last two questions and then we're going to be closing out. So Nitin, the idea is complete 9 questions and be on the 10th question at the end of 20th minute. That's the pacing chart. Okay. And Pragun had this question. Is it good to practice to learn from official questions which you have solved correctly and analyze them more? Pragun, I am a big believer in analysis. Okay. Big believer in analysis. I think when you solve official questions, if you have spent 2 minutes solving it, spend 10 minutes analyzing it. Your biggest growth is going to come from analysis of those questions, right? If you give me two students, one, both of whom have solved 100 questions. First one solved 100 questions with 60% accuracy. Second one solved with 40%. But the first one, after 60% accuracy, did not do anything. But the second guy, the guy with 40% accuracy, went back to those 100 questions, actually looked at it, learned from it, okay, and is able to, you know, apply it onto new questions. And now you give me another set of 100 questions. Who do you think I'm going to place my bet on? Do you think I'm going to place it on the first guy or the second guy? Let me tell you, I'll place it on the second guy. Where you have come from is not important. Where you're going is important, right? That's where I would like you to focus, which is, you know, make sure that you analyze and learn from your questions. I'll take the last one from Gyana Maya. Nice name. Let us say we attempt all questions spending 1.5 minutes average. Got max 10 questions wrong out of 36. What will be verbal score? Gyana Maya, the problem is it also depends on the position. Okay. This is the position of the mistake, because if you don't know the position, you will not be able to, you know, kind of this. What I'm going to do is I'm going to be kind of giving you a link. Okay. So I will post it over here. You can have a look on the chat window. Okay. So this is basically the link where I have explained the, so I've explained the algorithm, which is how the GMAT algorithm works. So that's where. So thanks a lot for whoever has joined. I'll still take the last one. Is it a bad thing to repeat questions while practicing? Shanti, I would say repeat the question, but this time around, I'm assuming that you're not really timing yourself. You're really going back to the question and asking yourself, A, what did I learn from that? Whenever, you know, we are here, we need to kind of ask ourselves, am I learning even when I'm practicing, correct? That's the key, right? That's what I would say. So great, in case it's the first time here, please subscribe to the GMAT Club channel. You're going to get a 7-day access to the GMAT Club test, which is for YouTube subscribers. So go ahead and click on that link, right? So that's all I had. Thanks a lot, everyone, for joining me today. And it was a great pleasure. As I said, please go ahead, like this video in case you like the content I have. I'll be coming back very soon with even more content. Thank you and have a great rest of the week.